We are so happy to have Dr. Glasser here today to answer our questions about the COVID-19 vaccine. So thanks for joining us, Dr. Glasser.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Perfect. So for those of you who might not know, or those on the call who might not know you, Dr. Glasser is the medical director of the hospitalist program at Baptist Jacksonville, but I'll let him introduce himself a little. He's been really busy recently, so just talk a little bit about what you've been doing and all our campuses you've been on, and that'd be great.
Sure. I mean, we're very busy sort of at all our campuses. We are, of course, are in the middle of a surge of COVID patients. So we're seminally involved in really delivering care to a majority of the patients in the system with COVID. I work at all four institutions, and this week, although JAX is my home base, I've been everywhere but JAX this week. So we are busy, as I said, in all our locations, and even in our freestanding EDs, we've gotten to the point where we're actually stationing a hospitalist in the freestanding EDs so that we can, care for COVID patients while they wait a bed, make sure that treatment gets instituted early. We're seeing a lot of COVID patients, and what's sort of distinguishing this round as compared to sort of the other surges that we saw, one in December and in January, and then one a little later, is really this group is sicker. They tend to be younger. We're seeing a higher mortality rate in this group. So the Delta variant is very real, and it's really of what we've seen, the most dangerous variant we've seen so far. We've had people, generally in the earlier surges that we had, the vast majority of people were older, were immunocompromised. Now we're seeing that there's a good proportion of our patients who are under 40 years of age. I think it's over a quarter of the patients are under 40 years of age, and I think 14% of the patients are below 30 years of age. So there are a lot of young people who are getting sick, and they're getting very sick. So they're having what we would classify severe disease, meaning that they're either on high flow O2, they're on other non-invasive ventilation like BiPAP or CPAP, or they're on mechanical ventilation. And we've had a few people in their 20s who I've personally helped take care of who ended up dying. So the old perception, I guess, was that this was mostly severely affecting older immunocompromised people, but we're definitely seeing with the Delta variant that it's affecting younger people and it's making them very sick.
Yeah, thanks for sharing that. So again, the topic, we wanted to focus on, I'm young and healthy. Why should I still get the vaccine? Can you talk a little bit about how the vaccine protects against the Delta variant and those antibodies versus maybe protection if you had a COVID-19 infection?
Sure. So what the vaccines do, at least the three that are commercially available in the United States, is they help produce antibodies to what's known as the spike protein of the coronavirus. So that is the area of the coronavirus which actually causes major attachment in your system and sort of spurs active infection. There are two vaccines, the Pfizer vaccine and the Moderna vaccine, that are both what we call mRNA vaccines. And what they do is they use pieces of messenger RNA to, if you will, take over your cell's protein manufacturing system and manufacture spike protein for you to develop antibodies to. Okay, so it's a non-infective particle. It's just that one small part of the coronavirus, but it forms a very strong immunogenic response. there have been a lot of people who were concerned, you know, it's mRNA. Is it going to affect my DNA? Is it going to change my genome? And the bottom line is, no, it doesn't. The mRNA doesn't go into your cell nucleus, and it's the nucleus where your DNA is kept. So it does not, you know, get incorporated into your host DNA. Those have been the most effective vaccines to date. So even against the Delta variant, just so you know, what we're seeing still is somewhere between 90 and 95% of the patients who are in the hospital are unvaccinated. So the vaccine is very effective at keeping people out of the hospital and keeping people from dying. It's still what we're seeing with Delta is there are increasing numbers of breakthrough infections. So in other words, if you are vaccinated, there's data coming out that people who are vaccinated are getting infected at a higher rate than they had with previous variants. Still not a high rate, but they are getting infected more so than they were with previous variants. What the vaccine is doing is it's keeping people from getting very sick, keeping people from coming to the hospital, and keeping people from dying. And those two have been particularly effective. There's another vaccine that's the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which is an adenovirus vector vaccine. That's a big mouthful, but basically what it does is it uses an adenovirus, which is sort of, most of your colds are adenovirus, and it's using an adenovirus vector that's been inactivated to introduce sort of a spike protein to, you know, so that you can make an immunologic response for that. It's a little less effective than the Moderna and the Pfizer vaccine, and especially so for the Delta variant, but it still offers reasonable protection. So I want to discourage anyone from getting it. If that's, you know, your only choice of vaccine, I would still enthusiastically recommend that you get it.
Perfect. Thank you. So there's a lot of talk about boosters right now, with the news last week that the CDC recommends a booster for those who are immunocompromised, and then potentially some news on the horizon soon about boosters for other Americans. So can you talk a little bit about boosters for immunocompromised and what you think might come up in the next week or two?
Sure. So the FDA has approved the use of Pfizer and Moderna vaccine booster for people who are immunocompromised. And those are people who've had chemotherapy, who have, you know, immune deficiency syndromes like HIV, people who are on immunosuppressive medicine. So like people who are on high dose steroids chronically, people who get Humira, methotrexate, or other medications for rheumatoid arthritis, for psoriatic arthritis, for, you know, inflammatory bowel disease. It's been recommended that those people get a booster vaccine. What they have found in these groups is that with time, the antibody response wanes. So they're finding that, you know, in people who are immunocompromised, usually within a 6 to 8 month period, their immunity starts waning because they weren't able to build up as strong an antibody response as someone who has a intact immune system. So they're encouraging people get a booster shot. And the booster shots, at least in vitro, are showing that they have quite a good increase in the amount of antibody that they're able to produce. There is some data coming out from Pfizer from Israel that shows that even in immunocompetent people, at about 8 months, you really start to see waning of the antibody response as well. And I know the FDA is discussing whether it's going to recommend recommend a booster shot for anyone who's been vaccinated, immunocompromised or not. They have not come out with that recommendation for all people yet, but they're talking that that may come out in the next 2 to 4 weeks.
Perfect. All right. Thanks for that update. So we're starting to get a few questions in the chat, and we received a few questions before this session as well. So I'll start with those, and anybody who is on the call can submit a question in the chat. So one of the most recent ones I got is, for a vaccinated person, is there a benefit to taking more units of vitamins? And if so, which vitamins?
So there are some small-scale studies that have shown potentially that there's, well, let's put it this way. It's shown that if you have vitamin D deficiency, you're more likely to get COVID. So there are people who are postulating that if you take vitamin D, supplemental vitamin D, it might be protective, but they're not large-scale studies that show that yet. But I would recommend that if you're vitamin D deficient, even if you're not taking a regular vitamin D supplement, probably doesn't have a lot of risk for you. Just the benefit is unknown. People are postulating that vitamin C also may have some protective effects. Again, nothing but very small, non-well-structured studies have been out there. But again, vitamin C is relatively non-toxic, doesn't have a lot of risk to it. So I wouldn't, if you're wanting to take vitamins, I would say vitamin C and vitamin D are probably the two most promising vitamins that you would want to supplement. And then there's some people who have also come up with small-scale studies that show there may be some benefit to zinc. Zinc's been shown previously in vitro to inhibit viral replication. However, again, no large-scale studies that show that zinc is effective. But again, very low risk in taking it. If you wanted to take those as supplements, those would be the supplements that I'd recommend taking. Other vitamins I've not heard of being effective.
All right, thank you. So, are you aware of any possible drug interactions with the vaccine, specifically toward mental health prescriptions such as mood stabilizers?
I'm not aware. As a matter of fact, there have been studies that have actually looked at that, and they found that there is no drug interaction really of any kind. There are side effects that can occur from the vaccine. They're generally almost to a large percentage are mild or moderate. They're usually local site infections, body soreness and aches, low grade fevers. Things like, small case of the flu for 24 to 48 hours. That's probably about 98% of all of the reactions to the vaccine. Still, the majority of people receive the vaccine without a problem. And what I would say is that I had both vaccines. The first one I had really nothing. The second one, I had a little soreness of my arm, a little fatigue. That was it. Certainly very manageable. I managed to work the day after I got my vaccine without problems. And I think most people are reporting the same. But as far as your original question, there's no medicine interaction that's known with the existing vaccines that have been approved with the FDA. And there's really been no observations that it's mood alter that either any of the vaccines are mood altering, other than, some people get cranky when they feel sore or they're running a low grade fever.
Perfect. Thank you. We're hearing a lot about monoclonal antibody treatment for COVID-19 lately. Is there any science on whether receiving that treatment could affect the efficacy of the COVID-19 vaccine afterward?
No, there's not. The monoclonal antibody therapy, first of all, is very short acting. So it's given an IV infusion. It's only in your system for a few days. And, there's really been no reported interaction. It doesn't impair your ability to get the vaccine, nor does it really in any way impair your ability to mount an immune response to the vaccine.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. What about people with Sjögren's syndrome? Should they receive a booster?
So, what I would say is it at this point, it depends on what medicines you're on for Sjögren's. If you're on immunosuppressive medication, then yes, you should receive a booster. If you're not on immunosuppressive medications, I don't know that there's great literature out there right now, but I will tell you that there is probably in the next 2 to 4 weeks, my guess is it's going to be an FDA recommendation that everyone who's been more than 8 months past their original vaccination series should probably get a booster.
Perfect. And is the booster the same as the first two shots?
Yes, it is.
Okay, perfect. And I guess it's recommended that if you got Pfizer for your first two doses, you get Pfizer for your booster, Moderna for first two doses, Moderna for booster.
That's at least at this point what they're recommending.
Okay.
There's not, I will tell you, there's not a large amount of evidence one way or other. Most public health experts are saying they're probably interchangeable, but the FDA recommendation is if you started on Pfizer to continue on Pfizer, if you started on Moderna to continue on Moderna.
Perfect. Okay. Two-part question. Has Dr. Glasser heard of antibody testing? And if the antibody test comes back to show strong antibody, is the COVID-19 vaccine still being encouraged? Would you still recommend the COVID-19 vaccine if you have antibodies from an infection?
Absolutely. So first of all, the antibody tests, so that what they do is they show if your body has sizable antibodies to coronavirus afterward. So generally you develop, if you were infected, you develop antibodies after your infection. What is the problem with the test is there's at least a 10% cross-reactivity of the test. So it's possible that you can be infected with other viruses, which are not COVID, and still test positive for having antibodies to coronavirus. Okay. So the test itself is not 100% accurate. Secondly, whether you've had COVID or not, still get the vaccine. If you've had COVID, the protection that natural COVID infection gives you is not as long lasting as vaccine protection. The antibodies that they see that are produced with COVID infection are, can wane a lot quicker than the antibody response they see with the vaccine. And if there are any football fans out there, you should know there are football players who've been repeatedly infected with COVID. So Lamar Jackson was infected last season with COVID and then showed up to camp this year and got infected with COVID again. So there are people who are reporting that they've been had multiple infections with COVID. So I would recommend that even if you have antibodies that are positive or you know that you've had COVID, if you've not been vaccinated, get vaccinated.
Awesome, thank you. Can the vaccine have potential interactions with those who have autoimmune disorders such as eczema or psoriasis?
So they're the only real issue that they've had with the vaccine is people who have had multiple allergies, anaphylactic allergic reactions to multiple either medications or vaccines in the past, and there is the potential for them to have, they're just more likely to react to vaccines in general, and there is a chance that they could have a higher incidence of having anaphylaxis to this vaccine, to the coronavirus vaccines. However, there's not, it's not been shown that getting the coronavirus will make your whatever autoimmune disease you have worse. Okay, there's no evidence that coronavirus vaccine or COVID vaccine makes your autoimmune disease any worse.
Perfect. Thank you. So, just reading a couple other questions. Thank you for submitting. Someone had a blood test that stated positive and another that stated negative. I've been vaccinated. What does this mean? And did the other test a nasal test as well, and it came out negative.
So there are false positives and false negatives. It's more likely to get a false negative than a false positive because it has more to do with sampling. If you don't get a good nasal sample or nasal pharyngeal sample, you know, it's more likely that you'll have a false negative test. But there is a small incidence of false positive. I would tell you, if you are having issues where you're unsure of how to interpret your tests, speak to your doctor or have your doctor make a referral over to an infectious disease doctor. But generally, I put more read into positive tests being truly positive than negative tests being truly negative. But I will tell you, the accuracy rate in both directions is very high.
Perfect. Is asthma, do people with moderate asthma qualify for a booster right now?
So you would qualify for a booster for asthma if you were taking immunosuppressive agents. So if you were on high dose steroids or chronic steroids for that, not necessarily inhaled, a steroid inhaler, but we're taking prednisone orally, you would qualify for a booster shot.
Perfect. So a question that we've gotten almost every week is about pregnancy and fertility and the COVID-19 vaccine. So tell us a little bit. What do you know about that? I will say, for those on the call who are curious, we did a session a couple weeks ago with two of our doctors who are amazing, a whole session on pregnancy, fertility, and the COVID-19 vaccine. So that's available on the Baptist Health YouTube page, but I also want to touch on it every week. I hear a lot about it, and I love learning more. So
this is probably the single most common question that I get, especially from nursing staff. But as far as pregnancy goes, the vaccine is safe in pregnancy. As a matter of fact, the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology recommend getting COVID vaccine for all pregnant patients. They do suggest that you speak about it with your obstetrician if you have any questions, but it is a recommendation that pregnant women get the COVID vaccine. There's been multiple studies also looking at the COVID vaccine's effect on fertility, and there's really no effect whatsoever on fertility rates in people who've gotten the COVID vaccine as compared to those who haven't. So it's very safe in pregnancy, and it does not affect your ability to get pregnant.
Thank you. So we have a question. Do you know the percentage of admitted patients with COVID who previously had COVID? So I don't have that data in front of me today, but I can work on getting that information. But just curious, like from your experience working with patients, what have you seen?
So we do see people who've had recurrent COVID infections. I can't, you know, I don't feel comfortable putting a percentage on that. Simply because it's not something I've really kept track of, but it's not unnoticeable. So if you've had previous COVID, you know, as I said before, it is well known that having a previous COVID infection does not protect you as long as having the vaccination.
Perfect. So I know you talked a little bit about breakthrough cases, getting the vaccine and still getting COVID, and that people often have more mild symptoms. We have someone who asked a question about, you know, they know people who haven't gotten the vaccine and have had COVID and had a mild case, people who have gotten the vaccine and the illness has still been pretty bad. Can you talk about why you still recommend the vaccine and just how this can happen?
Sure. So there are people who've had the vaccine who will get severe cases of COVID, and there even have been a few who've died. What we are seeing is that virtually all of those patients are either elderly or have significant comorbid conditions. So they have, you know, things that, they, you know, they've gotten chemotherapy, they have had renal transplants that they're on chronic immunosuppression for. So those people are going to be at higher risk to die from COVID, and are going to be higher risk to get COVID even if they're vaccinated, although the vaccine does give them really significant protection. As far as people who have relatively mild cases, you know, the majority of people who get COVID will have mild cases and not need hospitalization. Your risk for the need for hospitalization and for death increase as you get older and increase as you get more morbid conditions. Sorry, I can't speak. But with the Delta variant, we have definitely seen more and more people, or a higher percentage of infected people needing hospitalization. And we've seen a higher percentage of young people who've needed hospitalization and gotten very sick. And I will tell you, in the first couple of waves of COVID, I personally did not see anyone who, you know, was under 25 pass away from COVID. And I've seen a few in this wave. And I think that's really the thing that has most affected me in seeing this wave of COVID, is how much it's affecting younger people. And although there are a significant number who are asymptomatic and get, you know, recover well, there are also a number of people who get very sick and don't recover well and may have very long-term effects from having a COVID infection. I know of people who literally at 6 months so far are still having difficulty doing things like walking up a flight of stairs, who are having chronic coughs, who have chronic fatigue at this point, and that's being described more.
Yeah. Should someone with underlying conditions such as heart disease or Crohn's take additional precautions after getting the vaccine to avoid any of the unwanted side effects?
To avoid the side effects of the vaccine? Not really. I mean, there's no higher incidence of side effects of the vaccine in elderly or with, you know, comorbid conditions like heart disease, diabetes, obesity, than there is in those without. It may provide, you know, they're at higher risk if they get COVID, and they may be at higher risk to get COVID even than if vaccinated. Now, with that being said, you know, over 90% of the people who are vaccinated don't get COVID. Okay, so it's very protective. I don't want to put the message out there that, well, you know, you get COVID, but if you've got these conditions, you know, if you get the COVID vaccine, that's good. But if you have these conditions, it, you know, you're still going to get COVID. You're overwhelmingly not going to get COVID, but it does, having some of those conditions does increase your risk.
Perfect. So this is a good question. I've actually heard this from a couple different people, but this is from someone who's gone this long, it sounds like not vaccinated and has not been infected with COVID. Is the vaccine going to continue to protect me as well as my natural immunities have?
So I would say your natural immunities probably are not protecting you. What's protecting you is your personal hygiene and your personal actions. So, you know, if you mask and you socially distance, those are really good things to do to protect you from getting infected. They're not foolproof. And, you know, I would say that no, the vaccine is not going to affect your natural immunity, but it's going to significantly augment your natural immunity.
Thank you. So between Pfizer and Moderna, is there a recommendation that you have as to which vaccine you should get? People are, you know, they're going out, they're going to get the vaccine now that it's required at Baptist Health, and they're asking which one is better, Pfizer or Moderna? And this particular person is not necessarily interested in the Johnson & Johnson vaccine.
So I think with the Delta variant, before Delta, I mean, I think that Pfizer and Moderna were, you know, pretty equivalent. When they did their original tests, they were effective within one percentage point of each other. Johnson & Johnson was a little less effective. Initially, when they did their studies, they did more of their study participants in South Africa, which at that time had a variant they weren't sure was, you know, that the vaccines were going to protect from. With the Delta variant, what they are finding is that Moderna is probably the most effective. Pfizer is also significantly effective within a few percentage points of Moderna. And Johnson & Johnson is not quite as effective as Moderna and Pfizer. But I would say that Moderna and Pfizer are probably relatively equivalent. And what I would tell you is the big thing is to get vaccinated. If you get the opportunity to get vaccinated, really, if you have a choice of only one, it's the right one, okay? You will have better protection vaccinated even from Johnson & Johnson than you will without being vaccinated, okay? But Pfizer and Moderna, I don't know that there's a really sizable difference. Now, God only knows what's going to happen with future variants. But as of now, that's where the current state of the science stands.
Perfect. Thank you. Well, I cannot believe it's already 12:30. I feel like time flies when we do this, but I did want to let everyone on the call know that we continue to send emails about appointment opportunities at Baptist Health. We're looking at opening some larger clinics at Baptist Jacksonville and Baptist South, especially as people are getting their COVID-19 vaccine and their flu shot coming up. There's also an opportunity downtown this weekend with Walgreens to either get yourself vaccinated or your family members over the age of 12. So that's an opportunity that's also out there on the exchange and included in the weekly What's Up newsletter that went out yesterday. And you can get vaccinated at, you know, whatever location is most convenient for you. I use vaccines.gov to search different locations. And then you just send in your CDC vaccination card to employeehealth@bmcjax.com. So I know you all submitted a lot of great questions. We'll do another session coming up next week. So hopefully we can get to some of the questions that we didn't get to today. But thank you, Dr. Glasser, so much for being here with us. We appreciate it.
My pleasure. I just want to answer one. Can I answer one question that
Go for it. I think that's awesome. Yeah, go for it.
Yeah, one of the last questions that came up, it said, just FYI, I have not quarantined. I've had gatherings, been exposed to people who have had COVID, been to theme parks, water parks, eat out, etc. And I do not wear a mask unless forced to. I thought this was important to share, being Dr. Glasser's answer to my question. And I get that. I do think that that's, you know, I want to say that whether you get COVID or not, mask or unmask really comes down to a lot of things. So it's one of the things is how prevalent is COVID in your area? How close are you to people? And, you know, how often do you have these exposures? So sure, there are going to be people who, you know, have not altered their life at all. They don't mask, they'll go out to gatherings and have not picked up COVID, but it is a matter of odds. And the bottom line is whether you get COVID or not, if you're unprotected, is a math problem. And that math problem is about just those factors that I said. And the more you're out there unprotected, the more likely it is that you're going to get COVID if unprotected by vaccine. And that's all I really want to say. I think that I don't want to, you know, people have to live their lives ultimately as they see fit. I'm not here to tell them how to do that. I just really want to say that, you know, with it, COVID spread is a math problem. And that's why all the, you know, a lot of the mathematical models really do a good job at sort of predicting how high the surge goes and things like that. So, I would just tell you, take care of yourselves, protect yourselves. I certainly am a proponent of the vaccine because I know, you know, I've immersed myself in the data. And more than that, I've seen what happens to people who get sick with COVID. I see it every day. And at this point, almost every day, I see someone who dies from COVID. And that's really what I want to keep from happening. It really, it pains my heart that I have to see that every day. And I don't want that to happen to any staff member. I don't want it to happen to any patient, but I don't want it to happen to any staff member. So that's why I have my point of view as I have my point of view.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Thanks so much for answering that last question and just sharing some of your personal experience with all of us. We really appreciate it. All right, everyone. Thanks for joining. Thank you, Dr. Glasser, and we'll be back soon with another session. Appreciate you all.
Thank you for all your questions.
Thanks. Bye, everyone. Care.